What did your mom talk about a lot?
Mostly stuff that I cannot question and I don't know about.
Reading. She's trying to get me into reading, I just don't get it.
Taxes.
She doesn't talk about stuff she always thinks. She always thinks about Beyonce.
What's something your mom's always telling you?
Stop talking about the iPad. No iPad.
Go brush your teeth.
How does she know you didn't brush your teeth? She just knows.
I can't.
You can't remember? Oh.
No, I can't.
Oh, that's okay.
Clean my room.
Is your room get kind of dirty?
Kind of.
Kind of?
Kind of.
Would your mom say it's kind of dirty, or would your mom say, this is dirty?
Kind of.
Are you getting tired of my questions?
Kind of.
Kind of. Does she sing, like, worship music?
It's only my dad who sings worship music.
So your dad sings worship music and your mom sings Beyonce?
Yeah.
If your mom was a superhero, what would her superpowers be?
Fast, so she could just get the laundry done because we always have so much laundry.
So much laundry. Why would she need super speed, you think?
So she wouldn't be late anymore.
So
making people's ear hurt because how loud she sings.
She'd just go, and it would just stop the crime. What does she do at work?
She looks at people, or...
She looks at people?
Well...
That kind of sounds like Facebook.
No. Usually it's just messaging.
Just messaging. Just more, messaging. More, messaging. More and more messages. Just constantly. So how does your mom know that you love her?
I tell her that.
You tell her that?
Yeah.
Do you guys say it at the same time like you just did then, or no?
No. I give her hugs.
We play outside, and we ride our scooters and bike.
How do you know that mom loves you?
She does kind stuff.
Yeah.
For me, she does my hair pretty, and she always usually sings to me.
She cooks really good chicken,
spaghetti. She gives us hugs.
Mom hugs are the best, aren't they?
She says, you know what? And I say, you love me. And she's like, how'd you know that? Cause you always say it. Yeah, she always says it cause she loves me.
She's kind to me and my brother. She's kind to her whole family.
Why is your mom the best mom in the world, do you think?
The only reason is because it's my mom.
You love her just because she's mom?
Mm-hmm.
I love that. Awesome. Do you have any questions about my mom?
Nope.
Not interested at all about my mom?
Nope.
Okay. Fair enough. Great job.
Happy Mother's Day. Thank you so much to all our moms and those of you who are stepmoms and moms in spirit and mothers in all sorts of ways. We're so thankful for you on this Mother's Day. And so we just appreciate all you've done. We got a little gift for you up front in just a minute. We're going to take some time and give you a gift on this kind of cold and dreary Mother's Day. It didn't quite turn out like a beautiful day. Hey, for some of you who are introverts, this might be the ideal Mother's Day. Like if you want to get, you know, have somebody give you just a cup of coffee and tell you to sit down on the couch and watch whatever you want for the afternoon. Like, this could be the best Mother's Day ever. Either way, we're thankful for you. We're thankful for all that you do. We have this gift in just a minute. We're going to have a prayer, and then we're going to do a five-minute greeting. And kids, you can come up and get a Mother's Day present and take it back to your mom, your grandmother. If your mom's not here and you want to grab one for her, you can do that. If there's a mom in the group and you see that she, like maybe her kids are grown up and her kids aren't here today and you want to get one for her, go ahead and do that. So we have those in just a second. We are so thankful for all of the different moms that we have here at our congregation. I want to thank you as a church for your generosity. Last week we raised over $4,000 for At My Gate. So that's $4,000. I don't know if that's Steve, do we know if that's a record? That's pretty high up there, right? But it's a really great amount for At My Gate Sunday. Excuse me. So all of that is going to go to helping widows and orphans in Nigeria. It's a wonderful day. We already have a ton of updates from them. You know, they celebrated their first anniversary of the At My Gate Church of Christ. I got a ton of updates from them, videos, pictures of stuff that they're doing, baptisms that have happened. I'll be sharing those with you next week. So we're so glad to share that with you.
Today we get to worship together as we always do, and so if you're joining us online and you're watching on YouTube or Facebook, I just want to thank you for being here. If you're a guest and you made time on Mother's Day to come and be a part of this, I'm glad that you're here. If you have a prayer request, if you want to get to know somebody, if you want to get to know our church better, if you have questions about our church, you want to talk to a minister, an elder, pray with somebody, any of that, you can fill out one of those cards that's there and just leave that in the pew. We'll pick that right up. So thank you for joining us for worship today. And also today we're going to start a kind of a new series. It still shows us how to rebuild and rededicate. All year long we're going to be talking about what it looks like to rebuild and rededicate ourselves to the work of God. And so we'll be seeing more about that. Everything I say will be there. But we spend all this time letting kind of Nehemiah be our role model. And so we see all the ways that he rebuilds, about showing courage and hearing God and seeking companions to help and all of that. So now we're going to spend the rest of the year looking at passages from the New Testament that kind of give us nuts and bolts ways of building, of building and dedicating our lives, kind of what it really looks like. And so one of those passages is Romans 12. It is one of my favorite passages in the whole Bible. I could almost make Romans 12 a yearly theme. Like I was tempted to wait for next year and let Romans 12 be our theme. But I don't want to do that. It fits so well. So we're going to spend a lot of time in Romans 12. Let me encourage you now to start reading Romans 12. I'll give you the background. Here's the extra challenge I'll throw out, because some of us are going to try and do this. I would challenge you to memorize Romans 12. That's a lot of memory work. I don't know if you've ever tried to memorize a whole chapter of the book of the Bible. It is worth trying to do. And so I'm just going to throw that challenge out. Here's the good news. We're going in small bits. And so don't try to memorize Romans 12 this week, as if all of you are going to run and try to do that. But don't do that. Memorize it a bit at a time, starting with our reading for today, which will be Romans 1 and 2. It's small. It's simple. I'm not even there yet 100%, but I'm working on it, because it is worth having a passage that's in our memory like that. So if Christians could live out just Romans 12, if we could somehow take Romans 12 and live it out, I can't imagine what kind of a world we would be living in and the kind of reputation Christians would have. If Christians actually took seriously Romans 12 and did everything they could to live that out, it would be an amazing place. So we're going to talk about that and what that looks like. Just get familiar with that passage. In the meantime, we're here to share in the Lord's Supper, to be reminded of Jesus' death and his burial and his resurrection. And so I'm so glad that you're here for that. I'm so glad that you're here to celebrate that and be a part of that. And so we're going to do that as well. But first, we're going to start with a prayer. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to say a prayer, and then we're going to take 5 minutes. We'll start a little countdown timer. I want you, we haven't done this in forever, so let's use our opportunity to give out Mother's Day gifts and talk to people, meet someone, look around. Maybe there's somebody you haven't seen in a while and you just haven't had a chance to touch base with them. Do that. If there's a guest sitting around, say hi to them. We're just going to take you 5 minutes to do a greeting, distribute the gifts, and then we will and then we'll continue with our time of worship. So let's start with a prayer. Lord God, we praise you. We praise you for even this kind of cold and dreary morning. We thank you for Mother's Day and a chance to celebrate the moms in our midst, those who give, who are so instrumental in who we are and so good to us. And so we thank you for the moms here who give so much every day. And they know they don't do it because they're looking for some kind of Mother's Day gift. They do it because it's who they are. And so we're thankful for that. Lord, I pray that you will bless the moms here, those especially when it's such a hard job. I pray that you will strengthen them and encourage them. I pray that you'll be with them today, especially those who are kind of having to do it on their own for whatever reason that is, for somebody being deployed or underway or just whatever that is. We just thank you for those who are showing faithfulness there, and I pray that you'll bless them and give them courage and strength. God, I can't ever have come upon this day without also being mindful of the difficulty that Mother's Day is for some of us too. And so I just pray if there are people who are hurting and sad, maybe because their mom is no longer with them, or because their relationship with their mother is strained, or because their relationship with their children is strained, I pray that you'll bless them and be with them. I pray that you'll be with those who long to be mothers and can't be. I know that this is a complex day, and we're so thankful for moms We pray that you'll also be with those who are hurting some today as well. God, be with us now as we spend our time in worship. We thank you for your mercies. We're going to sing a lot about mercy to you, God, today, and that's because your mercy is great to us. And so I pray that you'll help us to be mindful of your great mercy and the mercy you've shown us in Jesus Christ. You've forgiven us. You've called us your children. You've given us a place with you. You've given us your Spirit to show us how to live. We are blessed richly because of your mercy. And so we thank you for that, and we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, let's take about 5 minutes. Kids, come up and get a Mother's Day gift for your moms. Say hello to somebody you haven't met before or seen in a while. We'll get going with worship again in about 5 minutes. Thanks for being here. If anybody needs some, there's more.
As Christians, we should all believe in the power and mystery of the Lord's Supper. As we gather around the communion table, it should remind us all of our desperate need for grace. Each week, many of us, and that includes myself, carry into this church a whole host of baggage from the past 6 days. However, on Sunday mornings, we have the opportunity to eat the bread and drink the cup with our Lord. Jesus says, "Come as you are." And although we approach the communion table with our baggage, stained, wounded hearts, and empty hands, we should also approach with anticipation, with longing and excitement and joy. Why? Because right now, Jesus is the host at this table. He invites us to feast for renewal, to wash us and reaffirm us of the Father's promise of forgiveness. Also for acceptance and mercy. And in turn, we should accept and embrace his forgiveness, to thank him for that mercy, and live with a heart of repentance. And I want to challenge everyone here to remember the cost of the cross, and as a result, how it can really change us. So when we go to prayer and ask for the blessing today, I hope Christ's presence is real to you. And when you close your eyes, you feel him right beside you. And it takes some imagination. But I think the more we picture his real presence, the easier it is to see him, not as the crucified, but as the resurrected King of creation. So the baggage we carry with us to the communion table can now be placed in Jesus' hands. God's covenant with us is renewed through the bread and the fruit of the vine. And we don't need to know how that happens. We only need to remember that it does. Let's pray. Dearly Father, we ask that you help us daily to renew our relationship with you, to strengthen our faith, to listen to your voice. At this time, we ask you to bless this bread that symbolizes the body of your Son, Jesus, who hung on that cross and died for our sins. We hope that we take this symbol in a manner that's pleasing to you. And it's through your Son we pray. Amen. Thank you. Let's continue in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for sending this, your Son down to earth to live among us, to die and may be resurrected. Lord, I ask you to please bless this fruit of the vine that represents the blood of from your Son's body. And we ask you to bless it, and we thank you so much for that. And it is in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Robert said to pick songs about mercy, so this one had to be included. I love this song, but I got a problem. I don't know where the mercy seat is. So, Robert, I hope that you're going to explain that. I know where it used to be.
Thank you.
So I hate to do this to you, but I'm going to make you stand up again. So I was at the Pepperdine Lectures. I'm going to talk a lot more about that. But one of the practices they had was having us stand for the reading of Scripture, just like we stand as we sing. We're going to be spending a lot of time in Romans 12, and I want to spend that time in honor of it. So if you are able, and that's the qualification that I want to make, is if you are able, I would like to invite you to stand as we read this Scripture together. This is Romans 12, starting in verse 1. This is Romans 12, 1 and 2. We will be spending the next 3 to 4 weeks on Romans 12, 1 and 2. That's it. So it's worth spending some time with. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will. That's the word of God for us. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you will help us to hear this word, to receive it. I pray that my words will not distract or take away or deny, but will deliver the word as you mean for it to be done. Help us to be hearers and doers in response. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now you may be seated. So, as I said, I was at the lectures at Pepperdine University this week. First time in 3 years we were able to do it. COVID just took it away like everything else. And so it was so good to be back there at Pepperdine and in Malibu, California, in Southern California. It's such a hard thing to do, but I did it for you. I went to Malibu for you. It was the sacrifice that when Paul asked us to be living sacrifices, I was a living sacrifice this week in Malibu, California. And so as I was traveling back on Friday night, one of the things that I like to do is there's an In-N-Out Burger right beside the airport, right by LAX. And you can literally sit out there and eat your In-N-Out Burgers and watch the planes fly over. It's a great way to kind of end or begin the trip. And I was there, and I'm not the only one that has that idea. That place is always packed. And I'm standing there. There's people from all over the world who have stopped by this In-N-Out Burger. And I'm sitting there waiting for my meal, and this guy comes up to me and says, "What in the world is somebody from Tennessee doing here?" And I had to think for a minute, like, how did you know that? And then I realized it was because I was wearing a Tennessee shirt, right? And so we got to talking. It turns out he's from Nashville. And we, you know, talked about just all the different, where he's from and where I'm from, what part of Nashville, and when we graduated and what high schools we went to and all that good stuff. And then eventually, and this always happens now when you start to talk about Nashville, Tennessee, inevitably one of us will say, "Can you believe how much Nashville has grown? Can you believe how big it has got? Isn't it crazy how much it's growing? I mean, everyone wants to move to Nashville right now, and all the building that's happening reflects that." Here's the Nashville that I grew up in. This is Nashville around 1980, which is still a decent-sized town. It's a city, probably of about, according to the internet, probably of about 520,000 people. This is the skyline of Nashville just 2 years ago in 2020. And even this is out of date. Already there are more high-rises being built in the last 2 years. It is now a city with a population of about 2 million people. It is astounding how much this place has grown. I go back once a year, and it changes every time I'm there. And one of the weirdest things, and this is what I always mention too when I'm talking to somebody, one of the weirdest experiences for me is it is now possible for me to get lost in my hometown. That I start driving and all of a sudden I don't recognize where I am anymore. This place that I spent the first 25 years of my life in, that I knew like the back of my hand, that I could go anywhere, I start driving sometimes and I look around and I have no idea where I am because everything has changed so much. But then it always happens that I know that what I have to do is if I'll just keep driving long enough, I'll see something. Something that I remember from back in 2000, the last time I lived there, you know, late 90s. and I'll recognize where I am. I'll see a building and I go, oh, that's that building. I mean, the surroundings have changed. It doesn't look anything like it. The street patterns are different. But I know where I am because I remember this landmark, this building that's there. And then I go, oh, I know where I am. And then I can start turning and figuring out where I am, and I can always find my way home. And it's because I found what we call a landmark, a place on the terrain that kind of serves as this reference point for everything else. It helps us get our bearings again. You know, we talk about having our bearings and knowing where is what. Or we can talk about it reorienting us, helping us figure out where the directions are. And I bring that up because this is what Paul is doing here for the church in Rome. This passage that we're going to spend a lot of time in Romans 12 is a reorientation passage. And the whole letter to the church in Rome is a letter of reorientation. A letter where Paul helps them get their bearings again. Because they have gone through something. An upheaval. Something has disrupted life in Rome. And we actually know what that was. If you don't mind me giving you a little history lesson, it'll help us understand Romans 12 and what I have to say today. Sometime in the 40s, the emperor of Rome, his name was Claudius, issued an edict. An edict means I get to say whatever I want and you do whatever I want. And his edict was that all the Jewish people that were in the city of Rome had to leave Rome. There wasn't a referendum. There wasn't a vote. The emperor of Rome said all of the Jewish people in Rome need to leave. Usually because of some disruption, perceived disruption to civic life. Usually because there's some racism involved or, you know, something like some hate that's involved. Usually because there's some perceived problem that this group of people is causing. And so the emperor Claudius said, I want all the Jewish people out. And we have references to that in the book of Acts, where the Jewish people had to leave. Here's the great irony. This is totally unrelated. One of the great ironies is that the word about Jesus, the gospel, the good news, went farther out in the world because of this thing that seemed so traumatic at the time, that seemed so awful that no one would have chosen. Because they left Rome, they went Priscilla and Aquila. You may know them. They're a couple that lived in Rome and end up going all over the Mediterranean world because they had to leave home. And so God made good come out of that. So Claudius says all the Jewish people have to leave, and they leave, and then Claudius dies. And guess what that means? It means all the Jewish people can come home. But in the meantime, at the church in Rome, it's not like the church in Rome shut down or closed their doors or quit existing. Guess who was at the church in Rome running things for themselves while all the Jewish people were gone? The Gentiles, right? So imagine what it's like for you as a Jewish Christian to have this home and then be told you have to leave, and finally you get to come back to Rome and you can't wait to go back to church on that first Sunday. You can't wait to see how things are. And you move back into town and you go to church on that Sunday and everything is different. Everything is so Gentile. They don't talk about the holy days anymore. They don't talk about circumcision like we used to. They don't talk about Abraham and the law of Moses like we used to. Everything has changed. I don't know where I am anymore. I'm lost in my hometown. And so you can imagine that a lot of conflict starts going because of that. And that's the reason that the letter to the Romans exists, is because Paul is trying to help this church reacclimate to the new reality, which is that there are Gentile Christians and Jewish Christians, but we're both Christians no matter who we are. And so I say all of that to say Paul needs to create some landmarks, some ways for us to know where we are, to know who they are and that things haven't changed. So the first 8 chapters is him putting them all in the same place. The Jewish people who think they're the best and the Gentile people who think they're the best. Paul says, I got bad news and good news. The bad news is this: none of you are the best. I have this t-shirt. It says, y'all need Jesus, right? And the first thing Paul wants to say in the letter to the Roman church is this: y'all need Jesus. And it's not just y'all, it's all y'all need Jesus. He starts with the Gentiles and he says, you Gentiles, you're a mess. And the Jewish people are over there going, yeah, get it, Paul. You're all a mess. You Gentiles are a mess. And then he turns and says, and you Jews, and they're like, yes, we are the chosen people. He says, you're a mess too. All of y'all need Jesus. That's what he says. The famous verse from the beginning of the letter to the Romans is, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. No matter who you are, all of you need that. He says we all need Jesus. There used to be this campaign from Dr. Pepper. It was, I'm a pepper, you're a pepper, wouldn't you like to be a pepper too? Like from back in the 80s. And you know, that's the idea, everybody's supposed to drink pepper, Dr. Pepper along with you. Paul's version is, I'm a heathen, you're a heathen. I don't know if you all want to be a heathen too, but that's the idea, right? But maybe you would like to be a heathen too. At least you'd like to be a forgiven heathen. Because that's the whole direction of the letter of Romans. Before Paul can invite them to work together, to be a church, to be the kind of people he wants them to be, he has to remind them that we are all heathens in need of the mercy of God. And it is good to be a heathen when you know that you are a forgiven heathen. A grace-shown heathen. A heathen who knows the mercy of God and lives in that mercy. And so there's this whole build in the beginning of the letter to the Romans of that, to the point where he gets to that famous chapter in Romans 7 where he talks about, you know, I'm kind of a mess. I find this law at work within me. I want to do the right thing. And whenever I want to do the right thing, I know the bad stuff is right there with me. And so when I want to do the good thing, I do the bad thing. It's just like this terrible statement of the predicament of human brokenness that all the Jewish people and all the Gentile people and Paul and me and all of us have, that we want to do what's right and we can't. And he builds to this great crescendo at the end where he says, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? This body that is just choosing the dead stuff all the time, that has this fascination that is not life. And here's the answer. Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. Paul says earlier, all are justified freely by his mercy. The way Paul wants to reorient this church and give them the place to be and help them understand who it is to say, here's where we start. We are all in need of mercy. If you want to build, put this as your foundation. The mercy that God has shown us in Jesus Christ. And then, only then, does he get to the building part. That's when he tells them how to live. That's when he tells them what to do. That's when he gets the practical stuff out of the way. He goes to the practical stuff only after he has sufficiently helped us understand that we have all sinned, no matter who we are, and fallen short of the glory of God. And all of us are saved through the mercy of Christ. And you see it right here in the passage that we read. Romans 12 is the so what chapter. It's the blueprint. It's the rebuild pattern for the life that we're supposed to do. And that's what we're going to spend time talking about, it because there's so much good practical wisdom. But before we do that, we have to do the main thing, which is to remember this roadmap for the church in Rome and the way it needs to go is started in a very specific way. Let's go back to verse 1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, here's the part you need to say, and so I want you to read it with me. In view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. So Paul says, here's our job. We get to be living sacrifices. And I'm going to say more about that next week and what that looks like and what it means, because it is a weird phrase, right? It's not something, you know, like, it's not really a great image, right? Because a sacrifice, you know, a sacrifice in the end, you know, it dies, right? That's the point of it being a sacrifice. It gets on the altar and it's burnt up. And Paul wants to use this image not as something that's burnt once, but as a thing that is a sacrifice over and over and over again. A living, continuing, devoted person to God. That's his urging. And Romans 12 is all about that. But what I want to spend time focusing on before we go on is the basis of it. The orientation of it, the landmark that he sets down. He's going to let them be a living sacrifice. So in response, you keep being devoted to the God who loves you and saves you everywhere you go. And the rest of Romans is just practical explanation. But before that, he gives them this landmark to keep them from getting lost. Therefore, let's do this again. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. This phrase, God's mercy, the concept, the picture, the image, it is the landmark to keep them from getting lost as they try to become living sacrifices. It helps them keep their bearings. It's the thing that they look at and they see and they know where they are in relation to it. I was thinking about different landmarks in different cities, no matter where you go. Like if you go to New York, you can usually look up and see a building that will provide a landmark. It will give you a view. Freedom Tower or the Empire State Building, you see it. If you go to places in Japan, no matter where you look on the skyline, there's an image of Mount Fuji somewhere, right? It is this towering symbol, this image, and it lets you know, like, no matter where you are, you can just about always turn and see Mount Fuji and figure out where you are in relationship to Mount Fuji. This idea of God's mercy, that's what this is too. So that no matter where you go, the one thing you can look to is go, oh, there's God's mercy. It's right there. Now I can go back to whatever it is I was doing. Because we need that landmark. Paul is calling on us to do some pretty difficult stuff here. Romans 12, and you're going to see it. I mean, we're going to spend some time doing it. He says stuff like this. Let me just kind of give you the little survey of the land. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Here's one for you. Honor one another above yourselves. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Live at peace with everyone. Being a living sacrifice is incredibly difficult. And I would say it's impossible if you don't have God's mercy as a landmark to keep you from getting lost. That's why he says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Because if you lose sight of God's mercy, it is incredibly difficult to do all of the other things. And that's why this matters. It is possible to look like you're walking in faith, like you're being a living sacrifice, and still get lost. Because you're using the wrong landmark. I found if I'm not using the mercy of God as my landmark, I lose my way, just like driving around in Nashville. Things change, and I need something to reorient me, and I need something that reminds me of where I am. And if I don't have God's mercy as a landmark, I end up doing things in a way that doesn't look like Jesus. So I'm doing all these things, but then I get bitter or resentful, or my actions seem hollow, or suddenly I'll be concentrating on it and I'll still be short-tempered, or as soon as things get difficult, I quit because it's like I'm lost. And I need something to draw me back and go, oh yeah, that's why I'm doing this. And the why is the mercy of God that reminds me of who I am. I think part of what happened in the pandemic, or has happened in the pandemic, with everything else that's happened in our country, I think this is kind of what's going on. I think people have lost their way. I think we've lost sight of God's mercy. There has not been enough mercy in the past 2 or 3 years. That's just a common thing. We have forgotten that we are all sinners who fall short of the glory of God. That we are all saved, not by our own strength or our own brains, but by the mercy of God. So we end up with all righteous anger and no mercy. You remember what Jesus says? I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And Paul is saying the same thing here. Yes, present yourselves as a living sacrifice. That's really what helps us going. But what really helps me keep going is knowing that as I'm presenting myself as a living sacrifice, I'm doing so in view of God's mercy. And Paul knows it's a lot to ask. If I could point to one thing that's been missing from the way everyone is treating one another, I would say it's been kind of a general absence of mercy. And Paul knows that it's a lot to be a whole burnt offering, holy and pleasing to God. So he says, don't lose sight of God's mercy in the middle of it. Let God's mercy be your landmark. It's going to help you find your way. So as you go along being a living sacrifice, building yourself up, you keep looking at the mercy of God. It's the point that we always have on the horizon to look at and know where we are. There's this old African-American song called Follow the Drinking Gourd. It was introduced into kind of the registry canon of folk songs in the early 20th century, but it goes back way beforehand. And the drinking gourd is the constellation, the Big Dipper. So you look up and it looks like a kind of a drinking gourd, a spoon, a gourd that people would use to get water out of the well. And the idea from it, and this is a legend, and there's even debate on how accurate it is or not, so I'll just put that out there. But the kind of general accepted notion is that the idea of follow the drinking gourd comes from the days when escaped African-American enslaved people would use the drinking gourd as their reference point as they made their way north to freedom. That when you are lost in a land that you do not know, if you'll just keep the Big Dipper in sight, if you'll keep the drinking gourd in sight, you'll know where you are and where you want to head. And God's mercy for the people in Rome and for us as well is like that drinking gourd. Paul says, fine, be a living sacrifice. But instead of following the drinking gourd, he says, follow God's mercy. Step by step, no matter where you are, be a living sacrifice in view, always in view, every day in view of God's mercy. Do not walk blind. Make sure you know where you are and that God's mercy is always in view. Let me ask you this. What would it look like in your life if everything you did in view of God's mercy? If it really was the constellation guiding your way, if it really is the landmark in the horizon by which you judge where you are at all times, how would it affect the way you treat your coworkers if you are always in view of God's mercy? How would it affect the kind of husband and wife you are if you are always in view of God's mercy? How would it affect the way we talk about politics if we're going to talk about politics if we always had God's mercy in view? How would it affect the way you drive from work and home again? How would it affect how you think about giving and generosity if you're always, always in view of the mercy that God has shown you? How would it affect the way you talk to and treat your children if you're always in view of God's mercy? Notice, it is still possible for there to be disagreement. It is still possible for there to be discipline. It is still possible for there to be for us to challenge one another. But whatever we do, doesn't it look different if we're challenging and disciplining and disagreeing in view of God's mercy? So that it is always there. When you disagree, you do so with God's mercy in view, so that it's always the landmark you look to in order to find your way. God's mercy becomes our true north. What would happen if we Christians really were like that? Like I said, last week I was out in California for Harbor Lectures at Pepperdine University, and it is beautiful out there. The weather is perfect. Here's the scenery from my dorm room. Can you imagine? How do you ever get studying done there? It's beautiful up there. If it makes you feel any better, gas is $6 a gallon. Took me an hour and a half to go 20 miles one day because I wanted to get around, and no one can afford to live there. It's not the perfect place. But even more than any of that, as good a time as I had and as wonderful as it was to be out there, that place isn't my home. It's not my home. It's not where I belong. You want to know how I know where my home is? Bring it up with me. I have this reminder every week of where my home is, and it's this right here. It's my phone, and let me tell you what I mean. You ever have this experience where you're in somebody in a place where you don't stay normally and you wake up in the middle of the night and there's this moment of like, where am I? What's going on? Like, where is the light and where is my phone and what is this bed? And you reach in the wrong direction and you can't find your thing. If you move around a lot, you probably have this experience all the time. And I have this, and you know, and I'm in Malibu, and I wake up in the middle of the night, and I'm in this weird dorm bed, and I don't know where my wife is, and I don't know what's going on, and I just kind of reach for a minute. And I always pick up my phone. Honestly, it's just to see what time it is. But then I hit the home screen, and my phone comes to life, and it made me think of something. And so I thought I would do a little experiment with you as well. I asked you to send me pictures of your home screens. Because I have this theory, and it turns out I was right, and I like being right, so I wanted to mention this to all of you, that your home screen is a good indication of what matters the most to you. And here's what you sent. You sent pictures to me, and almost all of them are one or two things. They are people, or they are places. And they're not just random people or places. There are the people and the places that mean something to us. Now, some of you are looking at it and you know what some of them are and some of you don't know. But I guarantee someone is seeing this picture and it means something to them because of who they are and the people that they love. And we intentionally choose that so that every time we look up our phone, we know this is home. This is what matters the most to us. It's the family and the loved ones that make us who we are. And that's what Paul is calling us back to as well. Here's the question. What if mercy was our spiritual home screen? What if it was the picture we keep to remind us of the place we always want to be and the type of person that we want to be as well? What if everything we did in view of God's mercy? What if it was always there to remind us as we fall short of the glory of God that we're rescued by the mercy of God, all of us alike? Let us live a life of holiness. Let us be living sacrifices, but let's do this always in view of God's mercy so that we know where we are and we know where our home is. I hope that mercy of God is your home as well. That you don't leave home without it. You remember that old American Express phrase? Make sure you never go home without it. I hope you never leave without the mercy of God. I hope that that is something that you've experienced. Because today, you have a chance to know that mercy through baptism, through Bible study. All of these things that we offer in a way, not just so you can jump through a hoop, but so that you can always have God's mercy in view. So I got a pop quiz right before my sermon. I had to do some research. What is the mercy seat? If I had a little bit of time, I'd have some pictures for you, but I don't. The mercy seat is the spot on the top of the Ark of the Covenant that sat in the Holy of Holies in the middle of the temple in Jerusalem. And the Ark of the Covenant is the image of the covenant that God made with his people. I am your God and you will be my people. And on the top of the Ark of the Covenant, there were two angels. If you've seen Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know what I'm talking about. With two angels pointing toward, their wings pointing toward the other. And the spot right there is the spot where God's presence is. And that is the mercy seat. It is the place that was accessed once a year as the Day of Atonement came around so they could access the atonement of God. And the place that God sits is the mercy seat in the temple. The word for mercy seat comes up in the New Testament as well. It comes up in Romans chapter 3, verse 25. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement. You know what it really says? God presented Christ as the mercy seat. Christ is the place where we access God's mercy. It is the presence of Christ that is the mercy seat for us. So that every time we look at Christ, we know. The picture of the temple in Revelation is a picture of Christ on the throne, his mercy enthroned among his people. So if you want to know where the mercy seat is now, I would say it is in heaven, seated upon the throne, interceding even now on our behalf. So the question is, will we live our lives in reflection of that mercy? Will we look to it every day? We let it determine how we treat one another, the words that we use, the giving that we do, the promises that we keep, will we always, in view of God's mercy, present ourselves as a holy sacrifice, a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God? That's the challenge before us. We'll get into the nuts and bolts of what it looks like in the coming weeks, but for now, let us do so in view of God's mercy. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your mercy. All of us are broken. All of us are sinful. All of us are unable to do things the way we should or ought to. Just something in our fallen DNA. And God, we want to be better. And sometimes we are and sometimes we're not. We want to be better at being better. But however we do, help us never to lose sight of your mercy. Help us to live this week with it as a landmark on our horizon, with it as an image on our phones, so that no matter what we do, we are always in view of your mercy. And help us to treat one another accordingly. We thank you for your mercy toward us. Help us to show that mercy toward others. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing.
But they're going away. And so please, if you're planning to attend, please let Robert know so that we know how much chicken we need to buy. So that's next Sunday after church. Are there any other announcements? Okay, let's pray. Dear Lord, we come before you and we thank you for our mothers. We thank you for the lives that they lead in reflection of your sacrifice and your mercy. Lord, help us to pattern our lives after this and what we learned about in Romans chapter 12 this morning, to be living sacrifices, reflections of your mercy, and a window for others in the world to you. Lord, we thank you for this. We thank you for this church. We ask your blessing. We ask for healing for those who are sick and safety for those who are traveling. And Lord, we ask that you take us through this week and bring us back next Sunday. In your son's name, amen.